I mean, listening to the words of that song. If the master of the heavens and the earth, the ocean and the skies lives in me, not part of him, not fractions of him, he doesn't come and go, he lives in me. Did you ever stop and ask yourself, if that is true, what do I need to worry about? If that is true, what even do I need to do for myself? If that God that created everything lives in me, well, tonight, we're going to consider first God's joy is always in us because that God lives in us. And because he lives in us and he says his joy is part of who he is, which lives in us, that joy is always available to us. Jesus is going to make a very startling statement tonight where he says, just before he goes to the cross, that's only 24 hours away in time frame in where we are in Scripture. And just before he goes, he says to his disciples, this life on earth is going to be very painful. Jesus said that. No exceptions. He as much as says marriages will be painful because there is no such thing as a perfect marriage on this earth. Kids will feel painful to parents on many occasions, even though they look like little angels when they were born. Those kids will feel very painful because this isn't a perfect world for them, and they're not perfect either, and therefore they will make many wrong choices. And parents who've made those choices and felt the consequences will see their kids making them. Jesus said, 24 hours before he went to the cross, life on earth is going to be very painful. He meant even parents at times will feel painful to their kids as they will say and do mean things. Parents will do that. He also meant finances will often feel painful. He knew the world he was leaving his disciples in and you and I was an imperfect world. So there would be no perfect financial situation. He knew that work would be painful to many, as many would hit times in life where they didn't have any work. Then too, Jesus knew our physical health would feel painful because none of us could avoid the deterioration of this body. I had no idea 6 months ago when I was jogging 4 miles a day and feeling great. The next day, within 48 hours, I'd be having quadruple bypass surgery. And my wife would be standing there. I can vaguely hear her in the arms of my sons, thinking that was the last time she'd see me. I was kind of drugged, so I didn't know for sure what was happening to me. But Jesus knew these things would occur because there's no perfect health in this life. Jesus knew that everything in this world was corrupted by sin. Everything on this earth. So nothing would be the way he originally created it. Think about it. Justice, what we call justice today. America's justice system. Is it perfect? Is it anywhere near perfect? No. Why isn't it? Because it's corrupted by sin. Jesus knew that even sometimes best friends would in time become worst enemies. Now, how in the world does that happen? But it does. Some of you have experienced that. He also knew this life would be painful because there'd be many single parents. Read Scripture. God didn't intend that, but he knew, because we live in a fallen world where everything is corrupted by sin. While when we're young, we have visions and dreams of how great this life and marriage is made in heaven and perfect kids and we're just on top of cloud nine. But he knew that that wasn't the truth. And that as we progress in age through life, we'd experience more of the truth and see more of the truth. Jesus knew that many parents would find themselves raising their children's children. It's not the way God intended it for it to be. But he knew this life was corrupt. That's why he tells his disciples that he's soon going to go away. In the actual time frame, it was about 24 hours. He's soon going to go away to the cross. And he tells them he's going to do that so he can send the Comforter, his Spirit, to come live in us. Now, what struck me here, big time, I'm 69, raised in a Christian home, son of a father preacher, graduate of a Bible school. I never understood this until the last 4, 5, 6 weeks in my study of this passage. Jesus said, this life is going to be difficult. And because I know that, I'm going away so I can send the Comforter, my Spirit, to live in you. And here's what struck me. If God knew life on this earth would be difficult to the point only his Spirit could comfort us, how important does that make keeping our eyes on the Lord and his word? And not just living back every day as we gain more stress, hoping for some circumstance that's so painful for us to either experience or see to change. But keeping our eyes on his word, where he continues to remind us that he is sovereign and that he is God. And that he loves us and he's caring for everything about us and about everything that we care for. And he's working everything according to his perfect will. If God knew that was the only true comfort, how important is it then for us to keep our eyes on him? With that, we're picking up where we left off last week in John chapter 16. Verses 16 to 18, and point 1 in your outline, we can never lose God's joy that's in us. Now, let me be sure to clarify here. I didn't say we can never lose our joy. I said we can never lose God's available joy to us, because the God of that joy is always in us. Often, our flesh sticks its ugly self up and robs us of that joy. But it doesn't have the power to do it, we'll see tonight, as we focus on the Lord. His joy is greater than any painful circumstance, praise the Lord. Verse 16 to 18. A little while and you will no longer see me, and again a little while and you will see me. Some of his disciples then said to one another, what is this thing he's telling us? A little while and you'll not see me, and again a little while and you will see me. And because I go to the Father? So they were saying, what is this that he says, a little while? We do not know what he is talking about. Now there's some debate here as to the period of time Jesus is referring to, where he says a little while and you won't see me, then a little while and you will. The common consensus of most Bible scholars is that a little while and you'll no longer see me refers to his death. That's tomorrow. And a little while, the second little while, and you will see me refers to his resurrection. We'll see when we get to chapter 20. Jesus appeared after his resurrection to Mary Magdalene and to all of his disciples. So this is what most Bible scholars believe you will see me refers to. Then verse 19 to 22. Jesus knew that they, the disciples, wished to question him. And he said to them, are you deliberating together about this, that I said a little while and you'll not see me, and again a little while you will see me? Truly, truly, I say to you, that you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will grieve, but your grief will be turned into joy. Whenever a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when she gives birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy that a child has been born into the world. Therefore, you too have grief now, but I will see you again, and your heart will rejoice, and no one will take your joy away from you. Jesus is likening here his soon coming death and resurrection to childbirth. Just as a mother goes through great pain in giving birth to a child, Jesus is saying he's soon going to go through great pain to give new birth to you and me. And that, he says, is going to cause the unsaved world to rejoice because they believe they're getting rid of him. When they crucify him on the cross and see him finally dead, they're going to rejoice. He says the disciples will initially weep and lament because of not understanding. However, verse 22 says they will rejoice as they become enlightened by the Holy Spirit to the fact that Christ's death, the very thing that occurred in front of their eyes, was necessary for their salvation and yours and my salvation. Then verse 22, the end again says, and no one will take your joy away from you. This is a wonderful, glorious statement, because it means, first, no one can ever take away our salvation. Jesus is saying that joy will stay with us forever. And I just love to see this over, and we're going to see it again before we end tonight's lesson. further in this chapter. I love to see the many times the Lord repeats this throughout Scripture, because hardly a week goes by and someone shares with me in some way, fearing they could lose their salvation. Someone in this Bible study said to me just a week or two ago, "Daryl, I get afraid at times God's going to leave me." Well, here's just one more assurance. He never will. He says again, no one will take your salvation joy. The joy of knowing that. The joy of feeling secure in that. No one can take that away from you. And we'll consider this a little further in a few minutes when we get to point two. Then also, no one will take away our joy means whenever we look to Christ, we experience His joy. Nothing can prevent that. You come to God's Word, and because God inhabits His words, meaning His words are more powerful than any fear, any frustration, any worry that you have. When you come to God's Word and you just read it or you listen to someone share it with you, you will feel it, because the author of those words is God Himself and He lives within you. And He will overcome that fear, that depression, that guilt, that worry. Those of you that have been attending this class, you've heard me say 100 times or more, go up to my office, look at my desk. You ought to go up once a month and see the new verses that I put there. I just love to take a verse that the Lord has really impacted me with and put it on a Post-it sticker and stick it right on the lip of my desk, so I've got 20 or 30 of them there that I can look at, Terry and Kelly, every day 10 times. Because when I look at that verse again, though I've seen it 100 times, I feel God's power in those words putting down the stress I was feeling before I read it. The worry I was feeling. The anger I was feeling. Psalm 16:11 says, "You will make known to me the path of life in your presence." In your presence, meaning whenever we look to the Lord, is what? Fullness of joy. Not in any circumstance getting better. In listening to the Lord's word as He reveals who He is to us and how much He loves us and His promise to care for us, and He's accomplished everything for us. You don't have to try to do anything. I told a lady in this class tonight, she came up and talked about how she was a third of the way through the new book I handed out, A Different Place, and how it was re-thrilling her about so many things we have shared in this Bible study. And I reminded her, do you remember when you came to me after I spoke at a certain place about our freedom in Christ, and you came up to me and your whole life was just riddled with so much fear, and you said, "I don't experience any of this." And she said, "Yes, I do, because that was because of my background and my teaching." And I says, "Now you're just glowing in the freedom God has brought to your life." And she says, "I am." That's the power of God's word. That's all she's been listening to. In your presence is fullness of joy. in your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So again, no matter how painful or tragic or devastating any earthly circumstance may be, when our thoughts turn to the Lord, He causes His indwelling joy to overcome our anger, our worry, our fear, our stress. His joy is always in me. It's always in you. And it is greater, Scripture tells us, than any power in our flesh. But sometimes our flesh distracts us and we get caught up in this and this and this, and it feels like hell, doesn't it? And as the Lord draws us back to focus on Him, it just feels wonderful again. Acts 2:28 in the King James also says, "Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance." I'll tell you what. I can't imagine any believer reading just these two verses that we shared and not feeling a tremendous magnetic attraction to God's word. To perhaps read less of other things that we're reading and go back and read this verse again and stick it here and put it up on the wall in my kitchen and put it up on a post-it, Steve, in my bedroom where I'm getting dressed every morning, those five verses, and just feel the power of God overcome the anxiety, the fear, whatever it is. Now, the reason we experience God's joy, whenever, every time we look to Christ, is because back in John 16, verse 33, the very last verse of this chapter, just jumping ahead for a minute, Jesus says, referring to what we've just talked about, "These things I've spoken to you so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world." Jesus says here His peace and joy are greater than any trouble the world can dish up, because He has overcome with His resurrection the greatest evil in the world, which was His crucifixion. Wait till we get a couple weeks in this lesson, and we get into the depth of His crucifixion, and we discuss the very fact that Jesus allowed the very people to mock Him and spit upon Him and believe they were killing Him and getting rid of Him forever. He allowed them to do that because He knew that was required to save them. Wait till we get and consider what kind of mercy it is in God that allows people out of their anger to kill their very forgiveness, their very source of forgiveness, Christ. And Christ allows it in order still to accomplish their forgiveness. Wait till we get in and consider what kind of mercy that is. But Jesus allowed it, and in part to prove that He was greater than any evil the world can dish up. So I don't care whether it's a person struggling with anger or struggling with resentment towards a parent or struggling with fear over this. I don't care how great the struggle is. Christ proved that His power is greater. What an attraction to just want to stay in communion with this God, with this power. Well, I just want us to notice again before going on, because I mentioned this in my intro remarks. Jesus says again in verse 33, in the world you have, in this world, John, you have, matter of fact, tribulation. Jesus didn't say in the world everything will be hunky-dory. He didn't say in this world your kids, if you really work hard at raising them, I promise you they'll never break your heart. He didn't say in this world you'll always have a job. He didn't say in this world your finances are just going to be a breeze. The Living Bible paraphrase reads, I've told you all this, verse 33. Jesus' concluding statement of the chapter. I've told you all this so that you will have peace of heart and mind here on earth. You will have many trials and sorrows. My special grandson, Hunter, they're all equally special, but he's special because he came with me tonight. He came to Bible study. And I said, Hunter, just tuck this away for down the road a little ways. I didn't tell him because everything's wonderful right now. And he doesn't need to know any different. Enjoy those young years. But I said, just tuck this away and let the Lord remind you of this. A little later, you'll need a little bit of this when you're your folks' age, but you can need a whole lot of it when you're grandpa and grandma's age. I told you all of this so that you'll have peace of heart and mind, because here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows, but cheer up, for I have overcome the world. Jesus is acknowledging again that everything from our finances to our health to our work to family circumstances to people we deal with throughout this life will feel painful at times. But he can bring peace to our hearts and minds. So he says, back in verse 23 to 25, in that day, referring to that day that he's been talking about when the Holy Spirit comes and indwells us, in that day you will not question me about anything. Truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you've asked for nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be made full. These things I've spoken to you in figurative language. An hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figurative language, but will tell you plainly of the Father, referring again to the Holy Spirit bringing enlightenment within us. Jesus is referring here to what he said, actually, several times in this book, and as recently back in chapter 15, verse 16, where he said, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give to you. And we saw just a few lessons ago when we studied that phrase, in my name means when we pray for anything according to Scripture. For example, when we pray for more of God's wisdom in our difficulty, when we pray for more of Christ's forgiving spirit towards others. Scripture promises to give us that. When we pray for more compassion, more patience, etc. God says, we experience it. Because God's purpose is to accomplish what His Word says increasingly in our life and conform us more and more to the life of Christ. When we pray for any of those things, He manifests them and increases them in our life. And as we pray for these things in no matter what difficulty, look at what the end of verse 24 again says. Ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be made full. So before we go to point two in just a minute, Jesus says 24 hours before He goes to the cross, how important was this on Jesus' heart and mind? Very. You disciples, whom I love with all my heart, and all of us who will follow later, the world you live in is going to be very painful. It's an imperfect world. It's depraved. Nothing will be the way I created it. And it has the potential to stress you out, fear you out, guilt you out. That's why people that don't have me in them are going to doctors, going to drugs, going to alcohol, going to sex, looking for relief. Because the pain will be that great at times. But I'm greater. And as you turn to me amidst any difficulty, because I am greater, I'll again bring peace and mind to your heart. Cheryl and I were having lunch with a couple recently, and they were sharing with us about some struggles in their marriage. And I said, you know, I may shock you if I tell you this. Is it okay if I do? And they said, well, is it okay if I shock you? And, well, okay. I said, are you ready for the shock? And they finally said, yes. And I said, you know, Cheryl and I have had difficulties in our marriage. You have? We thought you had the perfect marriage. No, there is no perfect marriage. I know hundreds of other ones besides my own. I haven't met one yet. Not everybody feels the freedom to tell you about the struggles in their marriage, but if they did have that freedom, you'll find out that they're struggling pretty much just like you are. Why? Because Jesus said nothing was going to be the way He originally created it. I said, you know, honestly, Cheryl was sitting there. I said she'd be the first to admit it. There's been times in our marriage when it's been extremely painful because of outside circumstances that we're both grieved to the point of almost wishing we would die on the spot and the Lord would take us to glory, and it looks so hopeless. But I said, many times, our marriage between the two of us has been painful. I said, we're opposites. You name any subject, and Cheryl and I are exact opposites. Now, how in the world does that come together and get along? Well, I said, even though I've told you what I have, I covet for you to have our marriage. How about that? We've had plenty of difficulty and stress and strains in our marriage, but I covet for you to have our marriage, and here's why. Because the Lord has brought us to understand, first, that our marriage will never be perfect, so we don't look for each other to be perfect in the way we treat one another, do you, Cheryl? We don't look for each other to be perfect in the way we treat one another, we both know. When our flesh, which we both hate in ourselves, offends the other. And we know when it does. We both know the only place there's peace is not by hoping our marriage is going to get better, but by looking to the Lord. And as we look to the Lord, He replaces the resentment that we're feeling, maybe even anger, maybe even stress, wishing it was different. He replaces it with His peace. One of you asked me, Steve asked me, how many times has that happened? Thousands over 48 years. I love sharing with you God's word that I know not only is true because God said it, but because I've experienced it. Every time we turn to the Lord, He manifests His peace and joy greater. Well, then secondly, Jesus wants us to know, while we face various trials on earth, because life isn't always going to be wonderful. The older we get, the more we see it. Right, Penny? Right, Cheryl? Who else is old here? Everybody else here is pretty young. Right, Pat? He wants us to know, as we continue to face these difficulties and trials, we can never lose the glory that awaits us in a few short years. Praise God is true. Boy, is this wonderful. Verse 26 to 28. In that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will request of the Father on your behalf. Let's stop here for just a minute. Jesus is just saying here, our belief in Christ removes the sin barrier between us and God. When Christ goes to the cross, pays the price for our sin, that removes the sin barrier between us and God to where we now have direct access to God. That's just what he's saying here. Then in verse 27 and 8, for the Father himself loves you. Put your name there. Steve, you put your name there. For the Father himself loves you, Steve Stefani. Quite a statement, huh? Because you have loved me, Christ, and have believed that I've come forth from the Father. I came forth from the Father, have come into the world. I am leaving the world again and going to the Father. Jesus says here, and I want you to see how simple this is again. This is just a praise God once again. God loves us because we love Christ. Not because we did five things. Not because we finally got rid of that bad habit. Not because we have no unconfessed sin in our life. Look at this verse. For the Father himself loves you because you have loved me. Is that what it says, John? Or did I add or subtract, leave out any words? God the Father loves you. And we'll tell you what that means in just a minute, which is glorious. Because you love Christ. And what does it mean for you to love Christ? He tells you. I don't know how we as Christians go on and add so much to Scripture. When you just sit down and say, Lord, set aside, if need be, past teaching. I'm not condemning it all. But just look at what Scripture says. For the Father himself loves you, put your name there, because you've loved me. And what does it mean to love Christ? And have believed that I came forth from the Father. Well, now have we read that before? Hundreds of times already in this Gospel of John. God loves us because we believe he came forth. Christ came forth from God, which really means we believe he is God. Look at verse 27 again. Because you have loved me and have believed that I came forth from the Father. So what Jesus is really saying here is that because we believe in Christ, period. Nothing about we're failing less and less each day. It's all about belief, which God gave us, we've seen. Because we believe in Christ, we're secure in God's love forever. Do you mind seeing this regularly, John? Isn't it glorious? I love to see it because it just confirms I didn't misunderstand the other 100 times that I've seen it. Simply, God loves me, meaning I'm secure in God's love because of one thing, because of the faith he gave me to believe in Christ, that Christ is God and he is my eternal life. Gloriously true. So simple. I don't know how many Christians have really stopped and thought about this or realize this. But most of what we consider to be salvation verses in Scripture, if you go back and look at them, and I'd encourage you to do it this week, and I'll give you a couple. If you look at those verses, which maybe some of us for years have thought of as the plan of salvation verse, here's how you become saved. They're not really telling us how to become saved, but telling us how to know we're saved and saved forever. Scripture was primarily written to believers. 1 John 5:13, just as an example, says, "These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God." So the same author over in 1 John at the end of the book is saying, "All these things I've written to you." Then he qualifies who they are, who believe in the name of the Son of God. "I've written all of this to you who believe in the name of Christ, so that you may know that you have eternal life." Isn't that wonderful? The Lord knew again, in this troubled world, our flesh would try to steal that joy from us. I didn't realize this for years. But most, again, of what we consider salvation verses are really confirming to believers that, ask yourself, do I believe in Christ? Do I truly believe that Jesus came from God? And he hung on the cross and died to pay the price for my sin, and he's God's gift of eternal life to me. Do I really believe that? If I believe that, God's given me that belief. We've seen that repeatedly in Scripture. If you have that belief, God's given it to you, and I want you to know, because you have that belief, that's the strongest evidence that you have eternal life. Eternal meaning God's life forever. This week, go back and look up the verse used mostly as an evangelistic verse. And I'm not saying it's wrong to use it that way. John 3:16. And just read the chapter. And you'll see that the chapter is written about believers. And John is just making a statement as he's moving through the chapter. "For God so loved the world," to believers, "that whosoever believes in him," if you're one of those that believes in him, "you can know that you have eternal life." Another favorite passage that I heard all my upbringing years, Romans 10:9-10. "If we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in our..." I heard that so often put into a structure as a plan of salvation verse. But read the verse just before it. Romans 10:8 says, "The faith I'm talking about is already in your heart." You're talking about it. You're speaking about it. And then Paul goes on and says, "So if you confess with your mouth," which is in, you're already doing, "that's evidence that you have eternal life." It's thrilling when you see that God put all of these verses here to confirm to believers time and again that their salvation is secure in him. Then in the last four verses back in John 16, Jesus illustrates why our salvation is totally secure. Verses 29 to 32. His disciples said, "Lo, now you are speaking plainly and are not using a figure of speech. Now we know that you know all things and have no need for anyone to question you. By this we believe that you came from God." Jesus answered them, "Do you now believe? Behold, an hour is coming and has already come for you to be scattered, each to his own home, and to leave me alone. And yet I am not alone because the Father is with me." Jesus concludes here, and you'll see this in just a minute, but let me tell you in summary. Jesus concludes here by saying that true saving faith only comes from the Holy Spirit in us. The disciples in verse 29 and 30 are making a very strong statement of their belief in Christ. And Jesus answers in verse 31, "Do you now believe?" Meaning, do you really believe in me? He's trying to draw out the best of them and in effect get them to say, "Yes, we really do believe." They've walked and talked with him. They've seen the miracles that he's done. And they're saying, "Yes, Lord, now we really believe." In verse 32, Jesus tells them, after they just said, "We really do believe," he tells them, "You want to know something? You're all soon going to desert me and leave me alone in spite of what you just said." Matthew 26:56 says of this time, "But all this has taken place to fulfill the scriptures of the prophets. Then all the disciples left him and fled." The point of these last few verses in John 16, and what a glorious point to end with, is that human faith, no matter how strong we think it is insufficient to save us. And only God's faith, which is the Holy Spirit in us, can give us true belief and keep us believing in Christ. He illustrated with the disciples that lived with him and watched him and admired him and came down to this last hour and said, "We really do believe." He illustrated that the best of human belief would walk away. It was not the kind of faith that he was talking about, that he was going away in 24 hours to send that faith back to live within them, which was God's faith that would never leave them. You want to see that in Scripture? And we conclude with this. Each time in my study I got down to this, I was weeping. I was. Jesus sees the best of man. That's the best of me. And he draws it out and says, "You think you're going to stay with?" "Yeah, we are. We really, Lord." And look at his mercy and grace. And he says, "I'm going to illustrate again why I'm going to go away and let man do to me what he's going to do. Because even that statement of yours is not enough to keep you saved." Now, any of you here that have ever wondered if you could lose your salvation, I can't imagine how you can walk out of here tonight and ever worry about that again. Jesus says, "I'm not going to allow you to have any control over your future salvation. I chose you to belong to me from the beginning, from before the world began. And I'm going to make sure I keep you belonging to me. I'm not going to rely on you. And you and I say what? Praise God, praise. You want to see that in Scripture? Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. In him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given as a pledge of our inheritance with a view to the redemption of God's own possession to the praise of his glory. As I tell you, I get to this point in this lesson and I feel myself weeping. God, you not only chose me, but you went to the cross in order to cleanse me so that you could indwell me. And you assumed all the responsibility for what you want to accomplish in me. And then you sealed me secure in you by putting yourself in me, so that it has nothing to do with me keeping myself saved. You mean, Lord, that's the definition of that mercy? Yeah. I didn't leave any of it up to you. I took care of it all for you. And I leave again saying, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. And I'll continue saying, praise God, throughout this next week till I see you next Thursday night.